President el-Sisi, thank you very much for this wonderful hospitality and for this spectacular organization. COP27, President Shukri, Your Majesties, Excellencies, dear friends. In just days, our planet's population will cross a new threshold. The 8 billionth member of our human family will be born. This milestone puts into perspective what this climate conference is all about. How will we answer when baby 8 billion is old enough to ask, what did you do for our world and for our planet when you had the chance? Excellencies, this UN Climate Conference is a reminder that the answer is in our hands. And the clock is ticking. We are in the fight of our lives, and we are losing. Greenhouse gas emissions keep growing. Global temperatures keep rising. And our planet is fast approaching tipping points that will make climate chaos irreversible. We are on a highway to climate hell with our foot still on the accelerator. The war in Ukraine, other conflicts have caused so much bloodshed and violence and had dramatic impacts all over the world. But we cannot accept that our attention is not focused on climate change. We must, of course, work together to support peace efforts and end the tremendous suffering. But climate change is on a different timeline and a different scale. It is a defining issue of our age. It is the central challenge of our century. It is unacceptable, outrageous, and self-defeating to put it on the back burner. Indeed, many of today's conflicts are linked with growing climate chaos. And the war in Ukraine has exposed the profound risks of our fossil fuel addiction. And today's crisis cannot be an excuse for backsliding or greenwashing. If anything, they are a reason for greater urgency, stronger action, and effective accountability. Excellencies, human activity is the cause of the climate problem, so human action must be the solution. Action to re-establish ambition, and action to rebuild trust, especially between North and South. The science is clear. Any hope of limiting temperature rise to 1.5 degrees means achieving global net zero emissions by 2050. But that 1.5 degree goal is on life support, and the machines are rattling. We are getting dangerously close to the point of no return. And to avoid that dire fate, all G20 countries must accelerate their transition now in these decades. Developed countries must take the lead, but emerging economies are also critical to bending the global emissions curve. Last year in Glasgow, I called for coalitions of support for high-emitting emerging economies to accelerate the transition from coal towards renewables. We are making progress with the Just Energy Transition partnerships, but much more is needed. And that is why at the beginning of COP27, I'm calling for a historic pact between developed and developing economies, and especially developed and emerging economies, a climate solidarity pact. A pact in which all countries make an extra effort to reduce emissions this decade in line with 1.5 degree goal. A pact in which wealthier countries and international financial institutions provide financial and technical assistance to help emerging economies speed their own renewable energy transition. A pact to end dependence on fossil fuels and the building of new coal plants, phasing out coal in OECD countries by 2030 and everywhere else by 2040. A pact that will provide universal, affordable, sustainable energy for all. a pact in which developed and emerging economies united on the common strategy and combined capacities and resources for the benefit of humankind. The two largest economies, the United States and China, have a particular responsibility to join efforts to make this pact a reality. And this is our only hope of meeting our climate goals. Humanity has a choice: cooperate or perish. It is either a climate solidarity pact or a collective suicide pact. Excellence, nous avons aussi désespérément besoin du pôle.
We also need progress in adaptation in order to reinforce our resilience to climate change now and in the future. Today, around 3.5 billion people are living in highly vulnerable countries, vulnerable to climate change. In Glasgow, in developed countries promised to double their contributions between now and 2025. We need a roadmap for implementation also. We need to recognize that this is a first stage. Adaptation resources must exceed 300 million per year by 2030. Half of the climate change funding must be focused on adaptation. International financial institutions and global development banks need to change their economic models, and they need to do their share to boost adaptation models. They must serve as tools to lever more financial resources to serve efforts to fight climate change. Countries and communities must have access to that funding, which must be funneled to key initiatives such as through the Adaptation Pipeline Accelerator.
We must acknowledge a harsh truth. There is no adapting to a growing number of catastrophic events causing enormous suffering around the world. The deadly impacts of climate change are here and now. Loss and damage can no longer be swept under the rug. It is a moral imperative. It is a fundamental question of international solidarity and climate justice. Those who contributed least to the climate crisis are reaping the whirlwind sown by others. And many are blindsided by impacts for which they had no warning or means of preparation. This is why I'm calling for a universal early warning system coverage within 5 years. And it is why I am asking that all governments tax the windfall profits of fossil fuel companies. Let's redirect that money to people struggling with rising food and energy prices and to countries suffering loss and damage caused by the climate crisis. On addressing loss and damage, this COP must agree on a clear, time-bound roadmap reflective of the scale and urgency of the challenge. And this roadmap must deliver effective institutional arrangements for financing. Getting concrete results on loss and damage is a litmus test of the commitment of the governments to the success of COP27. Excellencies and friends, the good news is that we know what to do, and we have the financial and technological tools to get the job done. It is time for nations to come together for implementation. It is time for international solidarity across the board. Solidarity that respects all human rights and guarantees, a safe space for environmental defenders and all actors in society to contribute to our climate response. Let's not forget that the war on nature is itself a massive violation of human rights. We need all hands on deck for faster, bolder climate action. A window of opportunity remains open, but only a narrow shaft of light remains. The global climate fight will be won or lost in this crucial decade on our watch. And one thing is certain: those that give up are sure to lose. So let's fight together and let's win. For the 8 billion members of our human family and for generations to come. Thank you.